Hello and welcome to the ADC Forum series, Surviving the Crisis and Building the Future Amidst the COVID-19 Pandemic. Today we're talking about evolving beyond the politics of denial with Adam Trombly. Adam's a scientist and inventor, and he's got expertise in astrophysics, atmospheric dynamics, geophysics, rotating and resonating electromagnetic systems, and environmental global modelling. He's tutored at top international universities. He's advised the US military. His family's been close to the Reagans, and he was an advisor, scientific advisor to the Reagan administration, as well as the Clinton administration in the US on a range of scientific issues. He's actually been the person who coined the term climate change as distinct from the greenhouse effect. And he's certainly more than your Renaissance man or average polymath. He's a comprehensivist within a world before interdisciplinary scientific term teams became accepted practice. And he also happens to be a notable figure in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. He's a lover of life, nature, and the planet. He's a protege of Buckminster Fuller, who encouraged the synergistic global view within a multidisciplinary scientific background, and who he co-founded Project Earth with, and Adam's the director of that at the Institute of Advanced Studies at Aspen. He's presented various breakthrough technologies and research to the United Nations. He also wrote the plan to put out the Kuwaiti oil fires after Operation Desert Storm, and filmed a lot of the footage that you've probably seen through the media related to that. To ignore his knowledge and insights, I think, is perhaps almost willful blindness when the trials of reality that confront us desperately need us to wake up and breathe new life into civilization so that we can keep going, even with rude shocks like the global fires through the Arctic, the US, Brazil, and the Australian bushfires this year, and pandemics like this one we're experiencing start to seem inevitable. Adam continues to research on life-promoting technologies and science, whether related to the environment or human health, and he's looked into and collaborated with experts across innumerable fields. So today we're going to be talking about both these challenges or crises and start to map ways to cut through the politics of denial, as well as the implications for economics and politics. Adam, we're in a very contested information space at the moment. Many citizens, many business leaders, politicians, and also quite a number of independent medical scientists are calling for the quarantine restrictions to be lifted to save the economy and perhaps our sanity. And those restrictions are starting to be lifted in different parts of the world, including here in Australia. Perhaps you might start by letting us know your thoughts about what's happening with COVID-19, whether the lifting of these restrictions is the right way to go. What do you think?
Well, having spent a great deal of the last several months in conference groups regarding the subject, and an unbelievable number of hours reading and trying to understand how this virus works, starting back in November, actually, when I was first alerted to the possibility of a big outbreak in Wuhan, whilst we were still overseas. I can tell you this, Anton, and that is that this virus is acting so unusually that some people question whether it's a virus. And when people are questioning whether it's even a virus because it does things that they've never heard of a virus doing before, it is a very interesting question indeed. Because in point of fact, this is from the very best people in the world that I've been privileged to spend quite a bit of time with in recent months. This is, among those people, I have not heard one of them question that this is an engineered virus. Not one. When it is carefully examined on a molecular level, there are so many different protein chains that have been inscribed into this virus, including HIV, for example, including various hepatitis. There's things that are inscribed into this that nobody's ever seen inscribed in anything before. And there's no way this would have taken thousands of years. Like herpes zoster is also, not the whole virus, but just chains of proteins that serve certain functions. So this is to net it out, it is an opportunistic, adaptogenic, restaging virus. There's already nearly 1,200 strains. And according to the Oxford-Cambridge study, where there are samples being sent from all over the world, it is not like anything we've ever seen. And that's the thing I hear over and over again. We've never seen anything like this. It can remain dormant in the system, and not just in an incubative sense. So 7 weeks after infection, with no symptoms appearing, it can suddenly appear symptomatically. It can infect the central nervous system. It can alter behavior. This is a very serious thing that we have to deal with here. It is incredibly difficult to imagine how we could possibly stay in lockdown for much longer. Nanometal particles, it turns out, are lethal to the coronavirus. And this is proven true back to 2003 with the first SARS coronavirus outbreak, which was, of course, a much less evolved or engineered virus, but nevertheless lethal to 20% of the people who became infected with it across all.
Do you mind starting again just with what we should do about it? Because we lost you for a few seconds on the connection. So you started talking about nanometals, but before that.
Okay. Well, we need something that can address the 1,200 mutations of this virus. Okay. So you have a real interesting process going on. We have people struggling to come up with a vaccine right now, obviously all over the world. It's a high stakes game, lots of money involved. But there's 1,200 mutations of this. So when you have 1,200 mutations of a virus that continues to evolve, and you have such a small sample of populations that have been tested, who knows how many mutations there really are. So coming up with a vaccine is going to be close to a miracle at this point. I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm saying you have to find the common denominator proteins to address. And that's how you have to target the vaccine, is by finding those common denominators between all 1,200 strains. And also at the same time, there's interesting research going on behind the scenes.
Yeah, right? We just lost the connection to you again, I think. So do you mind? So
there's a lot of
going behind the scenes and the 1,200 strains of the virus.
Okay. I was saying that I don't know where you cut off. So with the 1,200 strains of the virus, okay, according to the Oxford-Cambridge study, that's going ongoing, so it increases on a weekly basis as more samples are processed. You have the conundrum of having to find common proteins between all of those mutations. That's the thing you have to find. You have to find what it is that all of these mutations have in common. Is it impossible that we could come up or that they could come up with a vaccine? No, it's not impossible. It may be that we are all surprised and they will come up with something that is as intelligent as this highly engineered virus really is. And the thing about it is that there are also some other really exciting possibilities. Not just possibilities, but things that have shown a track record actually over the last couple of decades against coronavirus that could be at least used to reduce virus counts in people potentially. And we're suggesting that every country should experiment instead of offhand denying the possibility that such things could work. Nanometals, nanosilver, nanogold, nanozinc, those nanometal particulate, especially if you have it down to the point where you have like 1 nanometer silver particles, for example, those are small enough to penetrate into the molecular structure of the virus and interrupt it in terms of its entire replicate process. And also, it's possible, and not just possible, those particles do enter into the cells and they can actually block the receptors. Now, you don't want to block all the receptors like the ACE2 receptor because it actually potentiates the formation of angiostatin, which we all need for healthy cardiovascular health. So it turns out that it doesn't do that. It turns out that this can possibly be very effective over a large population at low cost, at least in the interim, to reduce the shock of this pandemic. We've seen it work. I've been fortunate to work with some physicians who have worked with even elderly patients up to 83 years old, who basically have recovered from the SARS-CoV virus using a protocol that included nanosilver particles. And all I can say is that, of course, is anecdotal, and I know there's going to be people who are saying, that's just nonsense, but it's not. There's a lot of things. If people would sit down at their own computers, go to Google Scholar and type in antiviral, antimicrobial qualities of nanosilver particles or nanometal particles, they would see that there's a really good amount of literature that shows how these things work, how nanoparticles actually can work. We have an entire world population that's been brought to its knees by this virus. I think we should try every single thing that we can possibly try, that especially when there's years and years of research behind it, to help us all. You see, we have adapted ourselves to ignoring what's going on in our own world. We've adapted ourselves to saying, that doesn't work. When in fact, most of the people who say that is a knee-jerk reaction have no idea what they're talking about. I mean, literally, they have no idea. They have no authority to say that. However, somehow or other, we get bullied as cultures by such individuals who tend to be aggressive and loud and obnoxious. But the fact of the matter is, there are other people who might raise serious questions about all of this as well, who are not loud and obnoxious. I'm not suggesting that they all are, but I'm saying that we owe it to ourselves to test these things in real time, in valid scientific studies, at our universities, in our laboratories, and especially because there's already a track record for it. And so why deny ourselves access to that? And again, instead of just having a knee-jerk reaction and saying that is ridiculous, which is, of course, people think that they have the authority to say that because certain governmental agencies in our country, the Food and Drug Administration, has come out viciously against it while ignoring the scientific literature that supports it. And it isn't everybody in the FDA that does that. It's a certain group of people. And I don't want to presage why they do that. But I'm telling you, Anton, this is such an ontological crisis right now that to deny ourselves access to something that has been used since Roman times, where Roman soldiers who were in the officers carried silver canteens to keep themselves from getting waterborne diseases, those who had the money to actually afford such a thing back then. I mean, this is not new. I mean, in ancient Israel, they put silver coins into water. They put silver coins into milk. And so to keep it fresh, to keep it from becoming infectious. So the bottom line here is that I'm just saying there's one avenue that should be explored, that everybody should explore. Silver is actually extraordinarily inexpensive on the market. And And so copious amounts of it could be used to create copious and really huge amounts of this material and just give it to broad swaths of a population, say to a test population in Melbourne of 10,000 people. It could be done with a few ounces of silver. I mean, literally, I'm not kidding. Maybe 8 ounces of silver. You could do like a 1 month study and see what happens with people who are mildly symptomatic, people who are not symptomatic. You could see if you were testing for virus counts, and that's another issue, is what kind of tests we're using. And it's astonishing how much competition there is to develop tests. Israel has just developed a breathe-in 1 minute test, literally, that's just coming onto the market in Israel. There are other countries, Germany and Austria, who've come up with saliva tests. The UK is starting to implement a saliva test because it's a lot less onerous than going up into somebody's nasal passages with a swab. So we have to get every country in the world has to get the testing into a protocol that works for the highest number of people in the shortest amount of time. We have to also recognize the characteristics of the virus such that we are taking into account that this is a stealthy virus, that this virus, very much like herpes zoster, can go into hiding, you know, like, and then you have an outbreak. Same thing can happen with this virus. People can be symptomatic, seem to be cured, and 3 months later, they're fully symptomatic, even with a more aggressive mutation of the virus that has adapted itself to their system. So what you need is something that can address the virus as it mutates and prevent it from mutating, hopefully, and eliminate it as much as possible. So we need to actually get serious about this and stop discounting things offhand, like we know what we're talking about, while ignoring the research, the copious research that's gone on that suggests that there are other tools, like there's nutrients. For example, one very prominent virologist has really been talking to us a lot at the Institute for Advanced Studies about the fact that everybody should be doing selenium and to block the entrance of the virus into our cells. And most people are selenium deficient. That's just another example. There's a whole list of things, nutrients, that are off the shelf, over the counter, that we can all buy. Vitamin C, vitamin D3 has been shown to be effective in reducing the severity of symptoms and preventing the onset of symptoms. Not just in of itself, of course you have to use K2, which is a synergistic molecule. So if you use K2 and D3 together, then you can actually make the highest use of 10,000 units a day, international units of vitamin D3 a day. It's amazing to hear some of the people who have never, in my experience over a long period of time, I've never heard them talking about nutrients the way they are now. But people are really not grasping at straws, but trying to find how many arrows we might have that we could fight this disease with. And I think that we need to be kind to ourselves and to each other, and to allow for this kind of innovation and not just rely on a vaccine that may be rushed and then tested and it looks like it's really good. And then 3 months later, we find out that it reduced something for 3 months and then it just came back. This is the real issue. People expect a cure. We've never found a cure for the coronavirus, which causes the common cold. Okay, so this is a much more daunting virus. This is a hugely daunting virus. Again, I've never seen so many people say or heard so many people say, people who are really senior, very, very experienced scientists say that they've never seen anything like this. So without a strategy to deal with that, then moving into openness, you know, into open exchange, people slapping hands again and all of the things that we all do because we're social beings, could be lethal. And obviously, if we stay in shutdown, that also could be lethal. So we have to find our creativity. We have to come together in a way that evolves beyond this kind of mere competitiveness and this chronic ability to shut out the possibilities that might help us, because we defeat our own help if we do that.
Yeah. So you're suggesting we need to innovate socially to be able to sort of, one, keep the economy going, keep our sanity as individuals, because we're by human nature social beings. But at the same time, we need to deal with the real cognitive dissonance that this is not going back to normal. It's actually dealing with a very serious virus. And we need to be much more innovative as well, as you're suggesting, in terms of exploring treatments for which there exists scientific literature already. But we need to be more open, perhaps, to exploring other options rather than hoping that there's going to be a vaccine, silver bullet, or some other particular treatment.
Exactly. And again, this is a matter of somebody taking the time, instead of having a knee-jerk reaction, somebody taking the time and actually doing the research online. If they'll do that, they'll be, I'm amazed because, every day I'm getting new papers. I even got a paper a couple of days ago about nano gold actually being effective against virus. Not in totally killing it off, but in certainly reducing the number of virus and the virus counts. Anything that we have, and it's very benign, nanometals are very different from the old colloidal, microcolloidal metals, okay? Those were clumpy. They tended to accumulate in joints, for example, in treatment of gold for arthritis, for example, tended to substitute the calcium for gold accumulation. It was ultimately stopped because of that.
Haven't there been comments about silver and blue skin as well?
Say that again.
If you take too much silver, your skin can go blue. Is that a risk?
Well, here's the thing. Not with nano silver. It's actually again a sign of a lack of information. There was the blue man, the famous blue man, basically is somebody who created something that he called colloidal silver, which in fact was basically silver nitrate, a contaminated silver nitrate. And that, if you take that all the time, that will turn you blue. Even though we put it into babies' eyes when they're born to prevent herpes virus from taking their eyes, the fact of the matter is that, and we've done that for decades and decades, and there's all kinds of ways silver has been used for a long time, and it's very effective. It's used in nanoform and materials too, but it does not turn you blue. It only turns you blue if it is made by somebody who doesn't know what they're doing, and they're using way too high of voltages, and they're not aware of the actual protocol that you need to follow. I can tell you, having ingested a lot of silver over the years, that I would be as blue as Krishna if it turned me blue. Okay, I'm hardly that color at all. and I can say this over populations. There's thousands of doctors in the United States that know this. There's hundreds of thousands, millions of patients even. I know this because I happen to know people in the business of this, and they can't keep up with demand in this country. It doesn't matter what the media says. Nobody trusts the media, like the corporate media is not very well trusted, at least in the United States it's not. And also so-called government experts who also have involvement in the actual research connected to this virus, which is really an unusual twist in the story. But I don't want to just spend all of our time talking about the virus.
Yeah, no, of course.
And on the other hand, we have got, this is a huge moment for us to stop and breathe and consider what got us here. How did we get here? Like, there's an article that came out today that in the Washington Post that talked about how if this had been 1 week, just in 1 week, the decision had made to shut things down, that just in that short period of time, 36,000 lives would have been saved. Okay. Yeah. And that's the kind of thing we're dealing with. We're dealing with a pandemic. We're dealing with a weaponized virus that has all kinds of bizarre characteristics, longevity on surfaces, it's airborne. It can be airborne, not just in droplets, but on pollution particles. In Bergamo, there's a study that just came out in Bergamo, Italy, that they found this, like the RNA from the virus floating around on particles of pollution. For real. Well,
that's really,
and these are viable molecules.
Yeah, that's interesting, isn't it? Because I think the WHO is recommending people stay 3 feet away from each other. Other countries are suggesting, you know, more like 1.5 meters or 6 feet.
Yeah.
And there seems to be a lot of scientific research come out that I've noticed over the last couple of months about it being airborne. Just wondering, like,
there is.
On the other hand, yeah. you've got people saying that that there's been a much greater role of science in looking at the virus in terms of the public conversation, and a lot of political leaders have sort of come to in terms of that. But they're saying, you know, going forward, you make the comment about you know, carbon emissions dropping because of the pandemic, because, you know, people aren't you know using cars and industry shut down. Why don't we sort of go maybe a bit more broadly into the politics of denial, because you also have a lot of experience in terms of the environment. And I guess I'm wondering whether you think science is being treated in the right way at a civilizational level for us to sort of continue to make progress in a way that's conducive to human prosperity and health and, you know, all the things that people want in their lives.
Well, that's exactly the point. Basically, science has become hamstrung and politicized, and which is, it's very difficult to do science in that kind of environment. Although in my own life, and I've been able to do pretty much whatever science I want to do, I've been extremely blessed, and so I am very grateful for that. There's a huge number of people who are struggling constantly to get funding for their research. And in their research proposals, they're being forced to go to corporations that are the same corporations that are killing the environment, for example. So you go to Dow Chemical, I shouldn't mention the name. You go to a certain company for a grant, and as a part of your grant proposal and their response to your grant proposal, they say, good, we're going to give you $5 million for this grant, but we have final editorial say-so over the work product. Well, when a corporation has final work product editorial powers, then it truncates the very reason, the existential reason for science in the first place. We're trying to
find... Are you talking about the scientific publication?
I'm talking about publication, yeah. Because since that is the way we communicate, and of course publication now is a vast number of things. This is publication. What we're doing right now is publication. What we're doing right now is we're communicating to however many people are listening, and in point of fact, so this has vastly expanded the opportunities and potentials. I know a lot of scientists who don't even go to major journals anymore. They go to academia.com. They go to various places that are open and that they can publish on. The problem with that is that there isn't peer review, and frequently some of the stuff that's published isn't so good, but also a lot of really good stuff is getting published. So we are on the brink of a very different kind of age of communication. This is a communicative breakthrough or communicative revolution that we must have in order to survive as a species. Because this politic of denial, for example, that extends to climate disruption, climate change, is in fact, like people say things to have said things to me for almost 50 years now, actually for 50 years now, since I was a lad, and when I first got involved with Project Earth was after the conversations with Buckminster Fuller, basically. People have said, well, we're just little creatures, you know, and the Earth is huge, you know, and so how could we have this big impact on Earth? But we fail to understand the cumulative impact of what we're doing. We've altered the chemical composition of our atmosphere to the point where within the next 50 years, we will reach a point where the balance, the thermal mass of gases in our atmosphere will be equal to what it was 56 million years ago. And 56 million years ago, there were no ice caps. And if there were no ice caps right now, believe me, all of our coastal cities would be inundated. And this is really already happening, because we've greatly underestimated. One of the things we projected 40 years ago, actually 36 years ago, we projected an exponential increase in the melting of glaciers. Okay, and in fact, that's what happened. Now, at the time we said it, even though we got on CNN with it and things like that, some people behind the scenes said, that's an exaggeration. That's never going to happen. These are huge glaciers. These guys are exaggerating what's going on. And in fact, it's exactly what has happened, because it was just as clear as it could possibly be. If you add this insulation to the atmosphere and you have a dynamo at the core of the Earth generating huge amounts of power, which has not been well understood because people aren't even taught about an experiment that was done in 1831 by Michael Faraday, which was the first unipolar generator experiment on December
26th. When you talk about a dynamo, are you referring to like a machine that converts kinetic to electrical energy?
Yes. Yeah, I am. And the reason I bring this up, obviously, is because I have experimental knowledge of it going back 1982, 1983. And then I, in 83, moved with Marcel Vogel from IBM into ringing resonance, which was silenced. We had a very successful program of research and experimentation, but it never reached the public eye. And again, this was because economic forces and political forces were controlling the future of the whole population of Earth. And it's like Nikola Tesla 100 years ago, inductively coupling into the magnetic field of Earth generated by the inner core, outer core, co-dynamo system, which is a lot more productive than people imagine, because they haven't been taught properly. And it's not because their professors have lied to them. Their professors weren't taught about it either. But the fact is that Nikola Tesla said there's this enormous amount of energy that is present all the time in the magnetic field of the Earth. He wasn't even talking about the zero point vacuum fluctuation background or any of those esoteric things. He was talking about the magnetic field of the planet. And he created an Earth amplifier, and he was able to generate massive amounts of electrical power, actually, that helped power Colorado Springs until agents for somebody burned his lab down there, and the first Earth amplifier was reduced to ashes. And there's all kinds of speculation about who that was, but that's not the point here. The point here is that for over a century, solutions have been offered over the shouts of resistance from the fossil fuel industry, from the nuclear industry, et cetera, that could have led and could even now lead to a much, much saner and more abundant future. We're at a crossroads right now. We are in an ontological threat from a virus, but before this virus ever appeared on the scene, we were in an ontological crisis with our environment. And this isn't something that people can deny. The oceans aren't going to stop rising because people say, that's not going to happen, or that's a lot of BS. The oceans are rising. And if you look at Venice, if you look at New York City, I have a young friend who was buying a large warehouse in Brooklyn a few years back. And he called me up and he said, Adam, when do you think sea level rise is going to affect where I am in Brooklyn? And I said, it could happen next week. And it just so happened that like a week and a half later, Hurricane Sandy happened. And because the sea level was already so high, the sea level rise triggered an addition to that by Hurricane Sandy, literally rose the water up to the point where it was 5 feet deep in that building.
Can we just go back to what you were saying about the Earth's core as a dynamo. I mean, that wasn't part of my, I guess, education around the climate science and how it might impact on climate change. Can you maybe explain what the connection is? Yeah. And also, would I be correct in thinking you don't think we're doing enough about climate change, or just maybe you could talk a bit about that?
We haven't even started. We really haven't even started to address the subject. If I have the blessing and the burden of literally 50 years of my life dedicated to this work, and I have colleagues, the ones that have survived, who are similarly aware of what's going on and the extreme crisis that we're actually in, and to see it shuffled off by bullying politicians. But with this kind of thuggy kind of attitude towards it, you know, and in support of whoever it is that's subsidizing their political campaigns or whatever they're subsidizing, I don't know altogether what their motive could possibly be to actually disable the planet. But the fact is, we have not been taught about this simple foundational experiment that Michael Faraday did in his laboratory in London on December 26 in 1831. And it was the unipolar generator. It's in his experiments with electricity and magnetism. It is right there. It seems to contradict his own law of induction because it was a cylindrical magnet that was glued to a copper disc and spinning in a beaker of mercury, which is how he ended up eventually with mercury poisoning. But the fact is that it showed that at least equal voltage was created as when there was relative motion between the magnet and the disc, which is the way everybody is taught it must be, that there must be relative motion between the magnet, the magnetic field carrier, and the conductor in whatever configuration that happens to be. Of course, in most things, it's not a disc. But this is the very beginning of electrical experimentation. So I was unaware of this. I mean, I'd gone through years of schooling, and I was unaware of this fact. And so a NASA scientist brought it to my attention, a guy named Rolf Schifranke. And Rolf Schifranke brought it to my attention that there was this thing called a homopolar generator that actually was monolithic, and the magnet could be spun with the copper disc. And this is the reason I'm talking about this, is because it's foundational for understanding about the core of our own planet. Okay. And the core of our own planet is just such a self-exciting dynamo, and has been so for billions of years. Okay, this isn't something that is just kind of Johnny come lately. This is how the dynamo of our planet works.
Michael Faraday is obviously an incredibly famous physicist. This experiment you're saying about the homopolar generator, it's obviously pretty significant. And it sounds like it's obviously got connection and relationship to climate change as well. Why are other scientists silent on these sort of issues or insights or scientific knowledge?
Well, it's one of those things that you learn when you're a scientist. There's certain things that get published, and there's certain things that don't get published. There's certain ways that you have to act, certain protocols you have to follow, which are corporate protocols. There are people who have a vested interest. The oil and gas industry, again, all of these different energy generating industries, which are centralized, are not wanting to be displaced. When in point of fact, we recently reached the point where a barrel of oil was actually being sold at a negative value in the U.S. market. It only lasted for a few days. They dumped all of that reserve into the strategic reserves or whatever they did. But the point here is that there have been economic and political motivations, basically greed. And not intelligent greed. I mean, there's no such thing as intelligent greed, I don't think. But it's not intelligent what people have done. You know, you don't destroy the planet that gives you life if you're an intelligent species. We aren't acting as an intelligent species. We've created a situation where we have built up. Okay, getting back to the inner core. Okay, the inner core is constantly generating incredible amounts of energy. Right now, as we are having this conversation, the inner core of the Earth is a very active dynamo spinning within its own magnetic field, generating huge amounts of electrical power. Now, because people weren't taught about Faraday's 1831 experiment, they actually have missed the fact that the inner core is the seat of the fundamental dipole moment or magnetic north-south orientation of the planet. And so since the inner core is the seat of this dipole moment, and then the outer core in a cogenerative sense, it has something we call magnetohydrodynamics, and it is a very significant, also very hot environment, generating lots of power. And that power is supposed to be broadcast out through the great capacitor of the mantle of the Earth. And then we have plasma discharge happening at the surface of the Earth, which we call lightning, and also extremely low frequency electromagnetic radiation going out into space, which is how the Earth relieves itself of the burden of the generation of its own energy, okay? And what we've done is we've put a huge amount of thermal mass into our atmosphere like a blanket. And everybody knows that's why we have blankets. It's as simple as that. It backs that heat up into the Earth. And so what happens when you back heat up into the Earth as a dynamo, which is constantly generating all this power? It actually goes into what we call a viscous crisis. And people say, oh, no, it couldn't. We just don't have that kind of power. But in point of fact, if you look at history, if we look at paleontological history going back 56 million years, you'll see the Earth in a much hotter period. And why was it in a much hotter period? Because of the gaseous content in the atmosphere, attenuating the rate of dissipation from the solid Earth into space. It's really pretty simple. And yet, it seems like a great abstract concept to people because it hasn't been discussed. We haven't been, Project Earth, it's been a huge part of my work for 40 years now, to talk about the fact, because I became aware of this, actually in 78, a friend of mine at NASA sent me a paper he was about to publish about Jupiter being a homopolar dynamo. And I was very, wow, I said, this is an amazing thing. And we had long conversations about it, because Jupiter actually produces more power than it can possibly be absorbing from the sun. And it's not through thermonuclear means that it does this. So I'm saying that there is a lot of science that backs up just the homopolar generator part of things. And then there's a lot of science that backs up that there is a whole field that is worthy of exploration, is being explored. Actually, I know for a fact within the U.S. government domain and other government domains, it's been explored and is being explored, and technologies are being developed that the public has no access to. Well, the public is financing this. We are financing it, just like we're financing one way or the other the response to the COVID epidemic, which got as bad as it did because our governments denied the severity of it. Our governments denied that they just kind of said, oh, it's just going to be another thing, don't worry about it so much. Mm-hmm. When in fact, if you deny the reality doesn't change. And in fact, as with COVID virus, it just gets worse. And as with the atmospheric dynamics of the Earth, we build up those gases. Not only does it back the heat up into the Earth, but that heat has to go somewhere. So we have more and more violent winds. We have a hotter and hotter ocean. In a conference call last year, a very well-known scientist said, but Adam, the atmosphere of the Earth isn't hot enough to justify how hot the oceans have become. And I said, of course not. You're blaming the air in the room for the kettle boiling, when in fact, it's the kettle that you are missing here. The kettle is the ocean basin. The fire beneath the kettle is the dynamo of the Earth. And so the oceans are much hotter than people who don't take the dynamo into account ever said it would be. We said this 40 years ago. We said it's going to be really a lot hotter than you guys think it's going to be. Mm-hmm. Because of what we're doing, because we need to stop this. We said in 1980, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, we were saying this is an emergency. I did presentation in 1989 at Dog Hammarskjöld Auditorium saying this is a global emergency and we have to address it. We also demonstrated technology physically in 1989 that actually worked and it was potentially a part of a solution. There was a huge response. Nobody heard a word about it because somebody from the White House got on the phone and called the head of the major networks. I know because I talked to these guys and they said, you're not going to believe what happened. So when you talk about a politic of denial, it isn't just that the populations of Earth are in denial. It's actually not so much the populations of Earth that are in denial. It's the populations of Earth that have not been educated to understand the possibilities that we all have. These are not somebody else's gifts. This is the way reality works. Every atom and molecule in this moment is being the dynamic modification of the space in which it appears. And that's all there is to it.
You've spoken a little bit about the politics of science and the sort of corporate constraints perhaps around some of the research that's been done. But I guess what sort of befuddles me is if there are economic interests in actually improving things as well, why are we so caught up in a situation of stasis? And do you think, can we get, and how do we get, the vested interests involved in being interested in the future of humanity in a much more positive way? And presumably the economic opportunities that are a result of that too.
Yeah, this could be the biggest, coming out of this crisis, which will either lead us into the deepest depression that has ever happened in the history of this planet, because also in the history of this planet, there's never been a time in recorded history where the whole planet has been brought to a stop for 6 weeks, for God's sake, 7 weeks now. It's never happened before. So we're going to have to adjust. And we also have simultaneously hundreds of tornadoes happening in the United States alone right now. And they're not just happening in the United States. They're happening in places they've never happened before. They're happening in Austria, for God's sakes. They're happening in Italy. We've had huge tornadoes happening where they've never been seen before. And it's because of the dynamic thermodynamic and thermoelectrodynamic tension that is in the Earth's atmosphere because of the fact that we've ignored the science. We've ignored the science. And so now we have the opportunity to say, oh my God, well, we've been doing this and we recognize that our leaders have been doing this and that the people who have been controlling the publication of science have been doing this. We, for the sake of our own survival as a species, literally, have to change course. Now, our very amazing Secretary General of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, a couple of years ago when there were a bunch of us that were in New York for the General Assembly. Well, he basically, and actually before that in another session of things in June of that year, basically between June and September, he had come out with a statement saying we had 2 years as a planet to start turning this around. He's also called for a global ceasefire. And during this place, so the part of the solutions here are doing the unimaginable thing. Now you have very aggressive nations who are highly armed. And we could get into, yes, the United States is highly armed. China is a threat, an ontological threat to this and that. The fact is the Chinese people are also dying from this virus because of the denial of their government, denying that it even was happening. And as you know, there's sanctions against Australia. And all of this is like, all of this is just noise that's drowning out a very simple, intelligent communication that we all must share in. And that is, it is time, and it's absolutely, absolutely a necessity. There isn't a choice, really, unless you just want to go into complete chaos. We are on the verge of that right now.
One of the criticisms of advanced democracies or mature democracies has been that they've sort of lost the plot a bit in terms of being able to deal with long-term issues. And I know, you've worked with the US military, obviously militaries and defense forces have focused on national security on a sort of constant basis, on a professional basis. That's their job. One of our former generals asks the question, how do we determine what what scientific objectives need to be set both nationally and globally? And how do we get governments and research institutions to take part in this process? And obviously, you know, eventually politicians and citizenry need to come for the ride as well. But, you know, we need to somehow, one, set the scientific objectives and get people aligned to those, but also somehow get democracies out of this kind of spiral of, you know, inaction.
Right. And that's a really good question. And in relationship to his question in particular, I can say that I was giving a lecture at Johns Hopkins in 1988, and I was approached after this lecture, which was very well received in their biggest auditorium, by a number of people from the U.S. military, high-ranking officers. And we sat down and caucused for a couple hours because they had recognized that climate change was actually the greatest threat to the security of the United States and every other country on Earth. By 1988, they had realized that, okay? Now, were they the ones who were successful in determining the agenda of the United States military? Obviously not, okay? And in answer to the question that you just brought forth, all I can say is we really have to realize that we make everything else a priority than the earth that we are on. And like suddenly, if something threatens our life immediately, like this virus, we can suddenly come up with trillions and trillions of pecuniary units, whether they're dollars or euros or whatever, you know, we can suddenly precipitate this and say, oh, well, we can address this because we recognize that it's an ontological threat. Well, we must recognize that the data is very clear, the real-time data, not the theoretical data, the real-time data from very capable satellite platforms and manned space flight from the space station in particular. I've been privy to manned space flight photography going back many decades, and to see the degradation on a large scale of this planet and to understand the scale of it is quite daunting to understand deforestation. And so we have to start looking at things like deforestation as a military threat to our stability as civilizations, because it creates huge amounts of oxygen. That oxygen is obviously what we breathe. We're consuming huge amounts of oxygen in internal combustion that isn't being replaced at the same rate. And it used to be kind of like the knee-jerk reaction of some people who call themselves scientists, that, oh, there's so much oxygen in the atmosphere, you could never put a dent into it. We were talking about the depletion of oxygen in the atmosphere 40 years ago, and there were people, never to my face, but there were people behind the scenes who were saying, ah, now that's ridiculous. In point of fact, now there is good scientific evidence that the oxygen tension in our atmosphere has been reduced. That is an ontological threat, and I would say that that is a military threat, if you want to take it as such, because the storms and the fires that we are experiencing due to climate change, which these guys who are fence-sitting, who are willing to just be fence-sitting and say, well, I'm really not sure, I don't really want to say for sure, you know, that's the famous scientific, oh, well, wishy-washy thing. Well, the fact of the matter is, the data isn't wishy-washy. The data is very, very clear. And our experience in life is very, very clear. Okay, there's the solid earth is heating up. It's driving gases out of the ground. Methane is coming out of the ground in places that it's never been seen before. And that can feed into forest fires. And suddenly forest fires become very difficult to fight. And even though nitrogen is extremely present in our atmosphere and we could contain it in such a way and we could be using nitrogen to fight forest fires, and we have successfully in Kuwait, for example, we've made a proposal to use liquid nitrogen snuffers that work very successfully in extinguishing several hundred oil fires, okay, out of the 670 or 669 or something that we counted when we were doing the actual aerial surveillance that I was physically participating in. And so there are things that we can do that people aren't doing that need to be done. And so in answer to his question is we have the tools. What we have to be willing to implement. We have to have the political will. People in a position of power, people in a position that they have influence need to exert their influence in such a way that it makes a difference. And if you end up with somebody who is an obstruction in huge offices, you know, then those people have to be removed from office. We need to establish mechanisms within our democracies that allow us to address real-time threats that come from within our own political domains. And I'm not going to get specific about any one country. Obviously, everybody's got their issues. There's a huge number of despots on this planet right now who are not helping with this process. We need to have a voice, or else I'm afraid, especially after the economic consequences of the last couple of months, we're going to have a very serious issue happening. That we need to have the vision to understand that people are hurting, and that people have been getting hurt by this for a very long time, not just this virus. We have to come together in a different way. So I don't want to be splintering between us and China and everybody being at war, because I mean it's just going to be an extinction event in and of itself. Why not? And I know I've been called naive for a very long time, but why not put our resources together, put our hearts together, put our minds together, and our souls, if you will, and with a will to life, instead of constantly investing in death, move on to the next evolutionary moment in human history. Beyond the politic of denial, beyond the inertia of saying no, 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 no to every innovation that comes along, because it threatens 0.1% or even less than that. It threatens a very, very tiny percentage of the human species. And yet somehow or other, the people who are in charge of policy need to be informed, need to be educated, and the tools are there. The data is there. It just needs to be communicated in a way that's effective. You can't deny the fires of Australia. You can't deny the fires in California. You cannot deny the flooding in Michigan today that came from two dams bursting, that were, you know, specified for something that was completely obsolete data. This continues to happen all over the world. One place after another, this continues to happen.
Adam, so I think
we need to come together. We need to revive. I think it's too late in the timeline of our world to reinvent the United Nations, but we really have to kick some butt there, pardon my expression, because we need that. And people say, oh no, that's just one world government, and they're going to defeat our sovereignty. What kind of sovereignty do you have? Your country is burning, my country is burning, all the countries of the world are burning and being blown away by the disturbances that we have created through our own actions collectively. What kind of a future does that afford us? Let's change our future. Let's do that. Let's exert the will in the World Economic Forum, in the world of all intelligence. We need to put the brakes on to the former momentums. And the virus is as horrible and terrible as it is much less terrible than it would have been if we hadn't finally listened to the scientific voice saying, wait a minute, you got to put the brakes on, you know. You got to do this now, or else it's going to be millions of people instead of a few hundred thousand. So the cynics go, well, only a few hundred thousand people have died, or half a million, or eventually a million or 2 million, whatever it ends up being over the next couple of years. It could be 3 or 4 million. But they say it's no big deal, you know? And then they use other standards. They say, you know, in this country, for example, somebody said on a conference call the other day, we lost almost 400,000 people last year to prescribed medications. And that happens to be true as well. But cumulatively, how did that happen? It's again the same thing. It is always about this moment of inertia. And it is the moment of inertia, this momentum towards hurtling our species and our planet towards death and destruction. Because that's what we've invested in. Let's invest in life. I'm going to keep saying this until I have no more breath, but invest in
it. Adam, I think I hear what you're saying. I think probably a lot of the listeners will have heard some really, you know, strong points and maybe also pieces of the puzzle, of the scientific puzzle, that were just, no, people didn't realize were on the playing board. I mean, as you said, you can continue talking about this. There's obviously an incredible amount of knowledge and information that's out there and that we need to be considering from a leadership point of view as well. I think we're going to have to find ways of continuing this discussion. But I'd just like to thank you very much. Very much appreciate your time and your insights. We thank you for joining us at ADC for this very interesting and important dialogue on the future of the planet and I guess the challenge of the politics of denial that you've brought to our attention. Thank you, Adam.
And thank you very much as well, Anton. I appreciate it as well.